So a couple of questions have come in about fundraising and finding investors. So I wonder if you could talk a little bit about, you know, some people are wondering, like, how do I know when it's time to go bigger? And then two, when I feel like it's time to do that, how do I get started if I don't have many, if any, connections in the investment world?
The when to fundraise is reasonably easy, which is you wait as long as you possibly can. The more you know before you put your hands out, the better. The less you raise before you want to raise more, the better. People sometimes feel, oh my gosh, if I don't take this idea and explode it to full scale immediately, well, someone's going to beat me to it. And yeah, maybe one out of 1,000 times that'll be the case. But the other 999 times, you are so much better off making sure you know what the hell you're doing on a small scale before you accelerate. You don't want to accelerate something until you know exactly what it is you want to accelerate. I just got off the phone before we jumped on here with an entrepreneur, and I don't want to reveal too much about it. But she had a business, and gosh, it had this beautiful website and this really beautiful product. She'd been running for like a year and a half, but she had not yet done the simple exercises to learn the simple unit economics of the business. And without knowing that, that was the most important thing to know. And she could have known that so much earlier and so much quicker and for so much less money, but she was so involved in saying it's got to be this scalable and ready and big and beautiful that she missed out on learning the important things. So for God's sake, learn the important things and keep it cheap and simple and ugly until you do. The longer you can hold off, the better. But when you go, oh my gosh, I think this is working. I do understand what my cost to acquire a customer is. I do understand my churn. I do understand my lifetime value. I do understand all these things I'm going to be bumping into about how to keep customers engaged and returning. And now I need to scale it some. That's when the time comes to say, let me go to the gasoline store and have them pour some gasoline on this fire, but not until then. And most of us don't know, quote unquote, I do. Most people don't walk around with a Rolodex full of investors they can immediately call. You do have to look for it. But back 30, 40 years ago when I got started, yeah, that was hard. I mean, for God's sake, now it is easy. I mean, go on AngelList. Almost every single city has an investors club. Almost every single city has these groups of people who are actively looking to get pitched by people like you. And if you don't know someone directly, you almost certainly know someone who knows someone directly. And so begin working your Rolodex. I hate to be harsh on these things, but if you can't find some people for you to run your idea by, it is a failure of effort and imagination. So go.
We had a question that came in from Chandra. How do you judge how much debt to take on when you're a startup?
Oh, it's a good question. So I'm going to split it into two parts. One question that gets asked a lot is, should I do debt or should I raise equity? In other words, should I borrow money, which I'm going to have to pay back, but which doesn't dilute me? Or should I take equity, which is wonderful. Once the money comes in, I don't need to pay it back, but now I have to give away some percentage of my company to get it. And so the first evaluation you have to say is, which of those two better suits would I need? I'm assuming you've already made the decision you need to get money from an external source, that you can't self-fund, you can't be scrappy, you can't do it with a friends and family, you know, injection. And you ask yourself the question, at this particular point in time, which is more dear to me? Which is more valuable to the company, money, cash, or equity? And usually in a very early stage company, wow, cash is so much more precious. You have so little of it. It needs to last you until some indeterminate point. It's really hard to get more. And so take the cash and give away the equity, of which you've got a ton of it. And it's way, way better to have 90% of something which has the money to pursue its goal than it is to have 100% of a company which is going broke. Now, maybe later in your life or earlier, if you're lucky enough to have positive cash flow, or you're not as worried about cash, or you're so successful, everyone's throwing money at you, then debt is a great way to finance things because it's non-dilutive. And that you can take the debt, you recognize that you have the future cash flows to pay it back. And it's a great way to leverage the speed of your company. Generally, and the third category I'd say is sometimes you can get loans which are pretty cushy, government loans, small business association, small business loans. But my general feeling is early stage companies are better off raising debt than raising, better off raising equity than doing debt. You just do not need that that hangover on you. And then the question of how much debt do you take on? If you do that, almost always, whether it's debt or equity, you need to take on enough money that you can get to the next proof point. And that will change each time. So if you're just starting out, it's, is my idea real? If you're doing a technology product, can I solve the technology problem? Once you've solved that and you're raising money, now you're saying I'm raising enough money to get to the point that I can prove customers want this. Once you've done that, now you go, I need to raise enough money to get to the next proof point, which might be, can I scale a sales force? The next proof point be, well, it works in the United States. Can I make it work internationally? But you always need to have that clear picture in mind and then back into how much will it take to get me there, and then factor it up by 30% to recognize the fact that you're going to get it wrong.
How do you set up your own company with little or no startup capital?
I assume by setup, you don't mean the legal setup. I assume you mean getting started. You don't need startup capital to start your own business. And I think it's a mistake that a lot of people make. You know, they have this classic definition of, you know, the startups kind of looking for the repeatable, scalable business model. And so they think you have to start out the gate with something repeatable and scalable. And that's completely not true. And in fact, I think the opposite. I think you should start with things that are non-repeatable and non-scalable. You don't need to have an app. You don't need to have infrastructure. You don't need to have your own warehouses. You don't need to manufacture lots of products. Hack it. Figure out ways to do things that are non-repeatable and non-scalable. Do it by hand. Do it in ways that if you are successful, you'll get killed. But that's great. I mean, I've used the example before, but people say, okay, I have this idea for an app. Now, how do I raise the money to hire the engineer? And how do I, and I'm going, don't use an app. Fake it. Do it all behind the scenes. I mean, there's a famous, you know, I don't know if you're familiar with Amazon's this service called Mechanical Turk. And what Mechanical Turk was back in the, I guess it was the late 1800s, was basically this robot which miraculously could do all kinds of advanced calculations. But what it was really doing was it had people hiding inside it doing the calculations. And that's how you start a company with no capital. Is on the outside, it looks like, oh my gosh, I have this incredible website which automatically figures out how to find out the cheapest flight and book a ticket, and then it automatically sends email. But it's not doing any of that crap automatically. You're taking it all and you're sitting down longhand and doing all these things. You're sending the emails out. You're figuring out what the cheapest flights are. And you're right. If that hits, you'll get crushed. You can't keep doing that because it's so labor intensive and so slow. But it's a perfect way to find out whether your idea is any good. And I've said this before, but it bears saying yet one more time, is the idea doesn't count. What's important is how clever you can be figuring out a quick, cheap, and easy way to try it. And the key to doing that is not building something repeatable, not building something scale. Now, I didn't answer your question directly, but I hope you figured out that what that does is allows you to start things and allows you to try things without having to raise money. You can do it all yourself.
Hey, if you like that video, click like and subscribe to see more of Entrepreneur in your feed. And let us know in the comments section a little bit about what business tips have worked for you. Thanks for watching.